We're doing burnouts with them in the street, and they ain't the size of a, they're not even the size of a push lawnmower, okay? And we're drag racing these things up and down the street, so it's just a riot to get together and do, so. But again, it's about how do you deploy it, to get your mind working on how do you deploy an electric vehicle. That is a fun part.
Does it charge normally, or does it like somehow have like the Bendia charging?
This one charges normally with that onboard charger.
Okay.
We are building one that self-charges.
Okay.
So not plugged in anything, sits there overnight in the corner all by itself and charges.
Battery swapper?
Uh-huh.
Tesla swapper?
Yeah, basically it's a little box. I don't build the box, switches build in the box.
Is that Bits?
Huh?
Bits doing that?
No, this feller inside.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we're kind of careful about talking about it on camera or anyplace
sorry.
Else.
We've
already talked about it more here at the conference than we planned on, because it is flubber. I mean, you know, I don't think it's going to work, but I know the bike will work. I know I'll get 110 miles on the charge with a three-place machine that has a sidecar on it, and it's lithium powered. Are we going to be able to charge that lithium? I have the charger there. Switch has got one of the guys here, Dustin, I call him Switch, is his nickname in his club.
Yeah, yeah.
His primary function is to get me 110 volts at 10 amps. If he can get me 110 volts AC at 10 amps, I can charge any of my electric vehicles out there in 6 to 8 hours. So any of them, a bicycle I can charge up in 5 minutes. So it's just, he's working on that part of it. Has he got it? We've got several running models, okay, but nothing that's up to full size at that amperage. You're talking about a K-dub, you know, and they're in here, if they had it, they'd show it to us, wouldn't you? So, and it's a nice thing, that's the nice thing about living here, though. My shop's just down the street a couple miles, you know, and I've got John and Peter and everybody else that are.
Yeah.
And Switch, wind him up and go get John. Don't talk to John. I don't want to. John will beat me up again. Okay. No, I'll come over and hold you then so he can hit you hard. He's getting old. And so it's kind of nice that way. They tell us when we're full of crap and when we're actually on the right track. And
cool.
And then, you know, we let them drive whatever new electric thing is that we built that day. And John's a hot rodder, so that makes it easy because John builds regular gas-powered stuff. And so we go to the same car shows, and so John and Chuck and the Eagles here are big sponsors of some of the car shows and stuff. So, nothing proprietary on there. It's
simple.
Yeah. The wiring diagrams are on those cards and things I was handing out the other day.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Yeah, so everything's there. Yeah, it's a.
Now, is this something we can download on a PDF file? Or?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and if you can't find it, send me a link, and I'll send it to you in a PDF file. Okay. You can download and print out. Not a problem. You can print it on any of those files.
Thank you.
So the AllTrack site, which sells this controller for $550, has wiring diagrams for every one of their controllers, including, and this is an AXE controller with no reverse. And then they have a circuit with reverse, and they have, so you, they'll lay out all the contactors, motor wiring, everything for you on the same sheet.
And what's that motor out of?
That's out of a pallet jack, a dumpster.
I was just going to ask you that.
You got it out of a...
I've got one at home, very similar to it.
Well, they threw it away. They threw it away, and I said, I can still use that motor, so I grabbed it out of the dumpster and rebuilt it.
That's what I did.
Basic straight-up pallet jack motor. I'll pull the cover off so you can see. We've rubbed on it a little bit, so it's got a lot of little extra brushes, but heavier brushes in it.
So you modded it?
Yeah, we modified it a little bit. So, but it's a good little running motor. It's been in there for 3 years like that. So taking the dust cover off of it.
Awesome.
We just flogged the crap out of this bike. it's a parts runner for the shop. Oh, I got to go get a wire. I got to go get something else and. So I just take off.
What's your distance?
It'll do 50 miles if I'm polite. If I'm just really hammering it, I can lay it down in 20. So if I'm all over it and having fun with it. Mm-hmm. So, but I've done as much as 50 miles with the thing, just under 50 miles.
That's beautiful. I love it. It's great job. What an awesome prototype.
Marine batteries. Why these? Everybody says, well, why these batteries and not Trojans and everything else? Well, on our board of directors, batteries supply outfit is on our board of directors on our local PIVA chapter, the Electric Auto Association. So they came up and they're in our club, and we have everybody in our club, okay, Avista, everybody else. We want business merging with the crazy guys that are out here building stuff electrically. And so the guy that works over there, who's on our board of directors, says, well, I'll give you batteries for $40 a piece. And I said, bitch, okay, big pimpin'. That's... So I got, you know, $240 worth of batteries on there. And they've been on there 3-4 years now and don't seem to be giving me any sign of fade. So
right on.
So, you know, you scrounge around, and how cheap can you build an electric vehicle for? I've built scooters for under $200. Mm-hmm. Scrounge the parts, scrounge old batteries, Bedini pulsed batteries, whatever way you can do it, mm-hmm. and put them on there. It's all basically the same wiring. It's not anything more different than this, or a car, or a scooter, or a skateboard. It's all the same thing. So, just how crazy you want to get.
So, LTD 440.
That's an old Kawasaki, and I took the swing arm off the back and made it a rigid bobber. And when I did that, I raised this tube up here, the primary neck. I raised this thing up about the backbone about 7 inches. So that moved this head up like this and lowered the bike. Okay, and then once I got that set up where I was going to lower it and figured out where I was going to go my batteries, and I made the rigid part on the back.
Mm-hmm.
So it took me all of 10 hours to do.
So what kind of drags were you getting out of this? What kind of times?
Oh, I haven't drag raced this thing. I just take it out on the street and have fun with
just
it.
Have fun?
No, the thing we drag racing, we're talking about the drag racing side, was all the guys that do all the drag racing, the Whalens and Roderick Wilde and guys at EV Parts and all that stuff. When they get together at the drag races, we have little electric pit bikes, and a lot of times we're racing these pit bikes back and forth.
Okay,
with each other.
I got you.
At the barbecue.
Just having fun.
You got hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of equipment there, and you're still racing these $200 pit bikes.
This thing should just bake that rear tire.
Oh, yeah, it will. Mm-hmm, no problem at all. And that's a small motor. That's only a 2-horse power jack motor, but at 72 volts, you know, you're putting out a bunch more power than that. 10 times that amount of power when you wick it up. So, yeah, it'll shred the back tire off, you know. Of course, what's the point?
I know.
What's fun with it is when you drive it someplace, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, I ride regular gas bikes and motorcycles and race motorcycles, dirt bikes and stuff, and sponsored a motocross team for years. And you know, I was always a little worried about taking this motorcycle out into the regular motorcycle crowd, and I still get thumbs up whenever I show up with a thing.
Do you?
I love it. Everybody loves it. That big surprise. It's just, well, because it's a slam bobber, and I don't care what power, as long as it's a bobber.
Yeah.
Everybody loves a rat bike, you know. And so they're kind of fun that way. What kind of
motor is it?
That's out of an old pallet jack motor, a small forklift.
It's a 36 volt.
They were thrown away, and I just rebuilt it.
Mm-hmm.
And the biggest thing I was worried about building this bike when I started building it, just for, you know, I was going to build it for this college lecture I had to go do, and I'd still go around all the colleges here in the Northwest and talk every once in a while. And the Wenatchee group's coming up next week to my shop. And so we get a lot of people coming in. The biggest thing I was worried about with this bike was that I would drive it past the skateboard park, and all the little skate fags would point and go, homo, as I went by. And that bugged me a little bit. So, but they never did it, so I thought I was doing okay at that point. That's how I evaluate things. If it's too gay to ride, I won't ride it.
So, what controls it?
The pulse width modulator on the bottom, a little all-track speed. Okay. That's an all-track speed controller.
Sure. Okay.
There's 90,000 of those out in the industry now. Literally, not over 90,000. Damon builds them over in Portland. And Damon was building speed controllers with Peter Zinkowski and Rich Rudman of Manzanita Microchargers and Oakmar of Zilla Speed Controllers. They were all building controllers and stuff together. So Damon says, I'm going to build all low speed stuff, or a low voltage stuff, you know, 72 volts and under. Yeah, 48 volts, 36 volts for the golf cart industry. Peter Zinkowski says, well, I'm going to build the Raptor speed controller, you know, $3,000 controller if you can get him to build them, and they're good. And I've got two or three of them up in my shop. And he's in Northern California. Rudman says, well, you're all hosed. I'm not going to build, like Omar says, I'm going to build the Zilla controller, which is used in drag racing quite a bit, the primary drag racing controller. And Rudman says, you're all hosed. I'm going to turn the pulse width modulator around and build chargers, Manzanita microchargers. So they all kind of split up, but they all see each other all the time anyway. And Damon sold more of them than anybody else because they're in the golf cart industry, mm-hmm. that 48 volt thing. So you're talking 90,000 units out there, you know. Wow. And the nice thing is they're all right here in the Northwest. Mm-hmm. So if I have a problem with that, I can drive over to Portland if they don't warranty it or something happens weird or I just am confused because I do that because I'm old. I can drive over and see Damon in Portland, and I can go, Damon, your controller's shit, and I can grab him by the throat and shake him to death. You can't do that with a guy in China.
Okay, so that's kind
of
why.
So how many hours? You've got a lot of battery there for this little bike. So.
Yeah, that's the nice thing about it. A lot of lead there. Well, you gotta see the lithium bikes are about one, about take two of these off, and then they go a lot farther. Yeah, about double the distance. Yeah.
But that still weighs less than a motor.
Yeah, well, this bike handles about like a double up machine and only weighs 40 pounds more than what the bike used to weigh when it was gas. Wow. Okay,
so really? It does weigh more?
Within 40, it weighs
I thought it would be less than the motor.
Yeah, a little bit more than the motor and the gas tank and everything else. It weighs about 30 or 40 pounds more. But the center of gravity is so slammed down.
I was going to say, that's really
low. You can just sit here and it just goes. You know? So, not enough front end. I wish I had more front end on it, but I built with what I had, the 440 front end, and I found some 500 wheels under another tree.
Is it kind of bouncy?
Gets a little bit of head shake if you're not prepared for it, so you get some of this up there in the front. It's the way the trail is set up on it. When I lowered the bike down in, I kept the same stock trail, and I should have probably added another half a degree to it.
Out?
Yeah.
Front?
Probably, just a little bit. And but it's very rare that it gets any head shake. Okay. So it's and I don't drive it very fast either. Most of the time I'm just around town having a ball with it, you know.
I say 10 more degrees out and some ape hangers and you're good to go.
Hey, I think so. Get some fuzzy dice for it and one of them hats with the spikes sticking up, you know. And it's about attitude. It's about having fun. You know, but now it's a real simple, all the parts are real available, no problem to get.
Great job.
Oh, thank you. It's just funny.
Now, what mods did you make from last year other than the batteries? Because I saw
that. I haven't done anything to it since last year.
Oh, you haven't?
No, this bike's the same as it was last year.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I haven't done a thing to it. I think I washed it once, got some of the grease off of it.
I thought it looked different.
Yeah. That's it, see? Other than that, I got a little of the grease off where the chain throws it, but other than that, No, it's a rat bike on pure and all the way through. It's lucky it doesn't have buffalo hide tape.
There's nothing better than a functional, reliable piece of equipment. I don't care what it looks like.
It just goes.
You know you can just get on it and go.
I'm done plugging it in, it just goes. Every once in a while, I'll grease a chain.
Awesome.
Make sure there's no dirt in the motor.
Thanks, Gordy.
You bet, anytime.